thank you for the introduction, Gregory. I would suggest that you can actually ignore the title of my presentation, because after reading the paper that Gregory sent me, I rethought my paper considerably and also expanded my presentation last night, so I hope I can keep to time. Please keep prompting me. So just to get an idea, I was wondering how many of you actually recognize this gentleman here? Thank you. Sorry? No. Anybody else? Well, I must say I'm highly disappointed. This is Sir Albert Howard. How many of you have actually heard of that name? Thank you very much. Now, just to compare, how many of you recognize this face? Norman Poe. Thank you very much. Accurately identified, and this actually makes a very good starting point for what Gregory writes in his paper as being, how is it that the sciences that are today recognized as sciences, and I would like to take it forward as sciences that are appreciated as the real sciences or the current sciences, how did they take that place? And I think for this analysis, a historical understanding is very important, because it was Albert Einstein who said that understanding of the historical and philosophical background actually makes us independent from the prejudices of our time. So some of the prejudices that we have right now, I would like to probably discuss, but within the context of my broad paper. Before coming to that, I have one more recognition question for you. Anybody recognizes this gentleman here? No, but I'm very glad about that, because this is actually Rockefeller. But, of course, everybody has heard of the name Rockefeller, I'm sure. And here is where, in my larger research, where the paper I'm presenting today is situated, I suggested that actually it was commercial interests that took India's attention away from the work that Albert Howard had done in India for more than three decades and focused it on the work of Norman Borlaug. Because if you see the works of Albert Howard, he had written The Testament of Agriculture and so on and so forth, where he recorded using conventional agriculture yields that have not even been matched today, and including the yields from hybrids, including the yields from high-yielding varieties created by Norman Borlaug, but Albert Howard was lost in history. So maybe I skip this in the interest of time, but coming to my actual paper. In my actual paper, I talk about the theory of public goods. Now, if you don't understand what public goods are, please raise your hand so I can explain a little. Otherwise, I will move forward. Okay. So public goods are essentially a theory in economics which states that any good which is in the common area, you can say, which are essentially identified as goods that have a non-rivalrous nature and which have a non-excludable nature. For example, if I'm saying that this is my mic, you know, if I'm holding this in my hand, then while I am using it, you cannot use it. If you try to use it while I'm using it, there will be rivalry. So this is not a non-rivalrous good. It's also not a non-excludable good. That means if I am using it and if I have right to use it right now, I can exclude you from using it, right? But now imagine a general public road. Yeah? Is it a rivalrous good? No, because the government says it's open for everybody to use. And just because I am using a road doesn't mean that less of it is available for you. And also, just because I am using the road, I cannot prevent you from using the road. Now, this theory of public goods, how does it come into intellectual property? And it says that knowledge is essentially a public good. So imagine a knowledge in the form of a musical creation, put into a CD, right? Now, if the CD is put out in the market and there's no property rights over it, then people can make multiple copies. If I am listening to the music, doesn't mean that you cannot listen to it. While I'm talking right now, it doesn't mean that you cannot record my talk and then publish it. As many people as are sitting in this room, those many copies of my talk can be made, because in the market that I'm imagining, there are no property rights on knowledge. Here, the economists say there is a problem. Because I, as a creator, for example, of this speech right now, if I'm making some valuable contribution to society and everybody can copy it claim it as their own, multiply it and sell it and make a lot of profit, then there is no incentive left for me anymore to continue making these kinds of very valuable talks. And so the economists say, give intellectual property rights so that there is an exclusivity created in the knowledge and the problem of free riding stops. So once this problem of free riding stops, what happens? You have incentive for innovation. Now, here again from Gregory's paper, I rethought, what do we mean by an incentive for innovation? Is it really just economic incentives? Or are we also talking about incentives such as a reputational enhancement? And here again, I thought this is very interesting in the sciences, of course, but it is particularly interesting in the agricultural sciences. Also, what do we mean by free riders? Are they free riders on economic benefits? Are they free riders on the reputation? Are they free riders on both? Again, as I will come forward at the end, towards the end, this question adopts more relevance in the agricultural sciences, particularly because of the existence in parallel of formal as well as informal innovation systems, as Ricardo was explaining earlier today. In my original paper, however, the question that I was looking at was primarily economic interests. And the question I asked was, do IP protection regimes in the agricultural seed sector follow the same logic that is being followed in other IP systems? So I thought, actually, very much so. This is where I started. Because seeds are self-replicating technologies, which means free rider problem is much worse here. Pretty much anybody with a spade and some soil and water can replicate your technology and therefore cause an immensely large and uncontrollable free rider problem. And breeders or formal Monsantos and Syngentas then don't have any incentive left anymore to innovate. But this solution was a little problematic for me because I come from India and Indians always have problems. My problem was that during the course of my research, I had heard from experts and also read in many, many papers that agricultural innovations, and mind you, in the formal sector, were ongoing very profitably since the 1960s. This was well before we even had UPOV somewhere nearabouts in India. We didn't have any trips coming up anywhere. There were no discussions. And yet, the private sector seed industry in India came to be established in the 1960s and flourished throughout the 80s and hit a huge segment of the market by the 90s. So what was their incentive to innovate? Were they innovating? Were they just multiplying seeds? What were they doing? So then I went ahead to question this because I'm not a scientist. You know, I have a pure law background and I'm pretty much dumb when it comes to technology. So I interviewed about, 2-3 dozen scientists to get answers to my questions. And finally, one of the agricultural scientists I interviewed, I actually asked her this question point blank. I was like, so what is the private sector doing in India? And how are they surviving? She's like, yeah, they're just creating F1 hybrids. And here, since the room is full of scientists, usually in a legal environment, I have to explain this slide more than anything else. What in the world are F1 hybrids? But essentially, F1 hybrids means that the variety cannot reproduce true to type, which means the farmers do not benefit by saving the seed. So the entire structure of the private sector industry in India was based on producing hybrids, selling them, and instructing them that don't save these seeds, because then you won't get the benefit in the second generation. So the farmers are caught into the entire system of having to go back to the market every year to buy seeds. Then I was excited. I was like, okay, so maybe things changed after 2001 because India introduced the plant variety protection system in 2001. Now, mind you, here again, I will explain a little more than I do in a legal audience because a plant variety protection system is very different from a patent system. In primarily that, unlike in a patent system, we have what are called breeder's exemptions. That is something like an experimental use exemption in patent law. That means if you are a competing plant breeder, you can take the varieties, experiment on them, and create new varieties, provided they are not essentially derived varieties. And there's also a strong farmer's exemption, or what's called a farmer's privilege. And in India, we have a unique provision called farmer's rights, where farmers are given the same rights as breeders if they come up with new varieties. So this is essentially a very brief nutshell explanation of the Indian law, and I wanted to see whether this law made any difference. Any guesses on that before I actually show you some statistics? No idea. Okay. So essentially I found that from the year 2007, that's when the registration of the data started, until last year, 80% of the private sector applications were either for hybrids or for transgenic hybrids or for parental lines that were used to create these hybrids. Only about 20% of the seeds were for what we call typical varieties, or varieties that reproduce true to type. Now, I was very curious. I was like, 20% is not a small number, so I want to look more closely at this 20%. And I saw, I was particularly interested in private sector applications for self-pollinating varieties, because these are really the varieties that farmers can save for many, many years without losing their viability and their strength. So I was like, in self-pollinating crops, what is the private sector doing? And I found that more than 95% of the self-pollinating variety applications more than 90% were for hybrids of rice. Rice is a self-pollinating variety, and I was like, how are they hybridizing rice? Now, you know, for all of you, it might be duh, but for me, it was a big question, and I went about asking again the scientists, and they said, yeah, this is because in recent times, they've come across the cytoplasmic genetics male sterility technology, by which you can create hybrids which do not reproduce true to type, also in rice, and to a smaller extent in wheat. Rice is showing better results, and so there's a lot of research focus on rice. But other than that, most of the private sector interest is in things like maize, cotton, sorghum, and this has remained the same even after the adoption of the law itself. What has changed is that within the same crops, there is a little bit more systematic and intensified research, but the overall broad R&D portfolio of the private sector in India has not changed since a long time now, and definitely from before the act was to be introduced. As you will see, within the rice variety applications, you will see most of them are for hybrids and for transgenic hybrids, but it is not surprising that they're also looking at typical varieties of rice. After all, they need some parental material, so they are also protecting rice varieties which are typical. But the interest is on those crops. They also now have growing interest in red gram. Red gram also has this, in red gram also recently this mutant variety has been identified which can help create F1 hybrids. And so there's growing interest also in red gram. So here I was brought to the question that, okay, you know, this means that the private sector has an incentive to do continuous research even in the absence of an IP regime. Because if you see hybrids, it's not only that farmers can not save seeds, but the parental lines are traditionally protected by a system similar to trade secrets. So parental lines are kept secret so that your competitor cannot compete with you, and farmers cannot save seeds. So why do you need an IP protection system on top of it? This was my question. And essentially the only answer I got from that was, yeah, it's an additional layer of protection for us. Just in case one of our scientists defects and goes to a competitor, we can still keep our parental lines safe. This was from a very broad perspective of this hammering on the table of, oh, we definitely need IP protection in plant varieties. It was definitely questionable, at least in the Indian context. Now, one would imagine that then you can say that, okay, this means that if you want the private sector to expand its R&D portfolio, give them patent rights. But then the question that Ricardo was raising comes up, but what about then in situ agrobiodiversity conservation? What about farmers' rights to save seeds? Because at the end of the day, if UPOV gives a farmer's privilege of saving seeds, and if you take away that privilege by giving patent rights, then in a country like India, where more than 50% of the population is farmers, and more than 80% of that population is small and marginal farmers, how are they going to now save seeds and save their costs? Here I came across another economics paper which claimed that actually farmers give, as Ricardo was saying, the raw material for formal innovations. Once this raw material is given to the formal sector improves this raw material and gives back to the farmers an improved variety. what is the incentive left then for the farmer to continue conserving and improving agrobiodiversity? Because a farmer is also an entrepreneur. He wants to increase his income beyond anything else. So if he has an improved high-yielding variety, then what incentive does he have anymore for agrobiodiversity conservation? Now, I didn't trust this paper because I was like, well, you may say this is true for a large country with large land holdings, but it's definitely not true for a country like India, where most people are living hand to mouth. So I actually did, which I will not explain here in detail, but I will just tell you the finding. I actually did a huge empirical survey in two parts of India to see what's going on when a farming group has improved varieties. It is still continuing agrobiodiversity conservation. And the answer I found statistically significant evidence suggesting that no. Even the smallest of small farmers, if they have the option between conserving agrobiodiversity and increasing their yield by adopting new seeds, they will jump to buying new seeds. And this, as you can imagine, is very problematic from the perspective of agrobiodiversity conservation and for the sustainability of the innovation process itself. Because if you don't have any more the weed left to go to create the improved broccoli, then somewhere along the line, you're going to bring innovation to be limited within the sphere of ex situ reserves and creations of private sector germplasms. So what were some of the conclusions that I reached? That you have to now not focus on promoting incentives for formal innovations, which, as we see in terminator technologies, in the cytoplasmic genetic male sterility, within the hybridization technology, we already have an inbuilt exclusivity system. What needs to be now almost incentivized is informal innovations and conservation of agrobiodiversity. Because otherwise we have a situation of imbalance created, which I wanted to show on this slide. And it's interesting that what is worsening this imbalance is in fact the fact that the government is promoting seed replacement. It's telling the farmers that even if you're using self-pollinating varieties of seed, change the seed every few years from the market. So then you can forget about agrobiodiversity conservation in situ altogether. So instead of coming to, since I have only 5 minutes left, I will come now to Gregory's paper a little bit. To begin with, I had a little bit of problem understanding the paper because maybe my brain is hardwired into the IP terminology, and I had a little bit of problem understanding your idea of priority claims, because priority has a specific meaning in patent law. So I don't know whether you were talking about patent wars, but I realized no. But beyond that, I had actually an interesting case study to present to you. And this is a rural innovator in India, Dadaji Ramji Khobragade. His name is more interesting than mine. He invented a new... Now, it's interesting. In this case study, he was cultivating a rice variety that was improved already by the public sector. And this was called the Patel 3 variety. It was introduced in his area in the 1970s sometimes. In 1983, so more than 10 years after he continued using it, he found in his rice field a variation of this variety, which he started collecting and saving. And he grew them and regrew them until it multiplied into large bags. And he sold them to a rich farmer in his village. And this rich farmer then went to multiply it further and took it to the market to sell. And the guy who bought it said, "What is this rice variety? I've never seen it before." And this man was at a loss because he didn't ask this man what the name was either. And in those days, there was a watch brand that was very famous in India called HMT. So he said, "Yeah, it's called HMT. So the rice got the name HMT. Now, this rice, because it was developed in a small landholding, he, by the way, owns less than 3 acres of land, he had developed this on a small landholding. So interestingly, this variety was particularly suited for small landholdings, and it spread like wildfire in his entire area, also in neighboring areas. And of course, the university in that area got to know about the variety. They came and very innocently bought a couple of bags from Khobragade. They did their own selections and improvements and got their own plant variety protection certificate on what they called the PKV-HMT. They even retained the name. It was very intelligent of them because they still wanted to sell the grain under the HMT brand. And here, if I studied this case very, very closely from the Indian law point of view to understand maybe he has a claim in our law. Maybe he can get a benefit share. Anybody here thinks he can get a benefit share? Anybody here thinks that he should get a benefit share? Yes. But the problem is that under the CBD, the only way you can get a benefit share, and also under Indian law, is if you are a conserver of traditional variety. And as I said, his starting point was not a traditional variety, but an improved variety. So here we have a classical situation where a downstream innovator of a variety has no rights under the law because he is neither here nor there. Neither is he a formal breeder, nor is he a traditional varieties protector, and so he has no protection. He has his own certification on the HMT variety, but there's absolutely no economic benefit accruing from that. He is an innovator per se, and here again I come back to what Ricardo was saying. He is an innovator. He is not interested, before this case came to his notice, in making himself a super duper rich man. But when it was fed into his head that, you know, oh, so much injustice has happened to you, now he's a rather unhappy man. You should see some of his interviews on YouTube. So it's very interesting where, you know, and this is where I feel that the IP narrow, IP broad framework needs to be expanded beyond even patent claims and productivity claims. This can be a productivity claim, but if you're talking about productivity claim from a formal scientific perspective, then in the agricultural sector, where informal innovations are really important, then you're leaving that out of the equation because you're still somewhere roaming around this commercial area which Rockefeller was interested in, but which Albert Howard was skipping and doing research on the ground with these real farmers. So if you're thinking of why science today is the way it is and why it has acquired legitimacy, then you have to go a little bit beyond patents and instruments which are purely set up from a commercial perspective. So that's essentially it. I had one more case study, but I will skip that.
Thank you very much.